Hello, grade fives, and welcome to your first history lesson for term two with me. Today we are going to be doing module 6, unit 1, from page 130 to 133, and we are going to be learning about the African farmers who settled in southern Africa. Now, up till now, we've been learning about the Khoikhoi and the Sand people, and we've been learning about their lifestyles and how they've used the environment for their own good. However, we know that they used it in a very responsible way. They never wasted and they never harmed anything in the environment. Now we're going to learn about how they changed and how they adapted to becoming farmers. Now, we know that they first lived a nomadic lifestyle. So if you look in your textbook on page 130, it actually tells you that up until about 10,000 years ago, most human societies lived a nomadic lifestyle. Now, what is a nomadic lifestyle? A nomadic lifestyle means that these people regularly moved from place to place. They never lived in one place for a long period of time. They would maybe every couple of weeks move to different places around the area. This is because of the animals that they hunted. They would move away, they wouldn't just stay. So in order to get the food and the meat, they would need to follow the patterns of movement of these animals. The same with the plants. The plants that they gathered weren't always available in certain places. They were they would only sometimes be available at certain times in other certain places. So the once finished in one area, the people had to then move to the next. This was very tiresome, and I'm sure it wasn't very convenient for these people. However, they then hit a light bulb moment and realized that if they could farm, it would make life a lot easier. This is because if they farmed, they would no longer have to walk long distances to go and find food, because the food would be right there. They would be able to grow their own crops and breed their own animals. However, with breeding their own animals, they didn't just use the animals for meat, they could use them for milk as well as for pulling plows and transport. This meant that they didn't have to move all over, they could settle in one place for a long period of time. However, with them being farmers, they would have large pieces of land. And these people had no concept of land ownership. They didn't know who owned what, even though the land belonged to the community. Now, what happens in these villages or in these communities, the chief and very important men would make decisions on how or what would happen with the land. And they would say who gets what pieces of land. And some men in this instance actually got bigger and better pieces of land, even though the individual was free to use land for whatever they needed. We need to learn that the Khoisan adapted to the environment. They didn't change the environment to suit them. They changed to suit the environment, okay? But they did look for fertile soil and grazing land. Why? Because they became farmers. They needed good land to grow their crops and grazing land so that their cattle and other animals could graze and feed off the land. Now, we learn as well that a lot of historians are very conflicted about the interaction between the Khoisan and the Bantu-speaking farmers. Okay, they argue about whether they only had conflict or whether there was cooperation as well. Now, we know that they became farmers. Now, the conflict would come in where they competed for land and water. However, there has been archaeological findings of the Khoisan people and the Bantu-speaking farmers having cooperated with each other. And we find this because a lot of Khoisan artifacts were found in the Bantu-speaking farmer settlements. And the farmers then adopted the click sound, which is found in the Xhosa language and the Zulu language that we hear. So we know that they spoke to each other and their languages merged as well. And with rock paintings, we can also see that there are cattle. The rock paintings show cattle, they show the farmers, and they show people with shields and spears. So we know they could have been fighting as well, and they were probably showing cooperation as well in those paintings. So just a quick explanation on this chapter. I hope it's easy enough for you. You remember, you can always contact me on Teams for any further information. Now you will complete the worksheets that I've sent out, as well as the activities that are listed in the workbook for weeks 1, 2, and 3. And if you need any help, I'm here to help you. Thank you so much, guys. And for our new listeners, we are using the Study and Master Social Sciences Learner Book, Grade 5, from page 130 to 133.